Nandita Das has never told a usual story. She has never followed a usual path, neither in her role as an actor nor in her directorial instincts. As an actor, she has done over 40 films in 10 languages and been much awarded. As a director, in 2008 with Firaq, she showed us where her storytelling instincts were going to take her, and that movie went on to win 20 major awards. It went to festivals around the country. It was celebrated. But it is with Manto when she took on the formidable task of writing about a writer that virtually nobody alive had met. Most of the people who knew or had met Manto were long dead. And to make that film is not just a cinematic journey. It is a journey of documentation of a writer's journey himself, that is an act that she has performed on behalf of society. She has documented one man's trace for our roots and for his own. It is an absolute pleasure to have her on stage to ask and to start the conversation of why Manto consumed her and why he must consume us all.
Manto would have said Hiptullah, which is what he said for Cheers, so I have a bit of a bad throat, so here is some Hiptullah.
Nandita, there's many, many places to start this from, but I'd like to ask, after you made a film that took 6 years, right, why did the need for a book, Manto and I, and the title is very telling, why did the need for that book still stay with you? This is your first book.
Yes. I think like everything else, it's never been by design. I finished the film and then there were still so many stories inside my head, so many things that I hadn't shared in interviews, not even with family and friends. And I had sort of lived with Manto since 2012. So, you know, 6 years, I think I just didn't know how to kind of move on. And this was my subconscious way of continuing the Manto journey. And that's when I felt like, why don't I start writing, just chronicling? It was more than being just having this feeling of being cathartic, but actually sharing what goes behind making a film. I, for one, do enjoy listening to a singer when they're rehearsing. You know, the process, the journey of, it's not just the outcome, but the journey is so fascinating. As a daughter of a painter, I remember thoroughly enjoying and just sitting at the back, just watching my father paint and how the lines and how the forms start coming on canvas. So I just think that it is fascinating because the art and the artist are inseparable. You know, even in the film, if some of you who have watched it would see that I've also interspersed his story with the stories written by him. And that decision I took very early on because I felt if I want to tell the story about the man, how would you understand the man till you didn't really see glimpses of his stories? It's not enough for me to tell you that he was a great writer, he was very sensitive, he had a special empathy for sex workers who were margined in the society, or he was deeply impacted by partition. You needed to see it. And at the same time, to appreciate his work, you needed to know the man. What made him? Why did he tell these stories? So I think similarly, I just felt that I wanted to share the journey, and the book is really like a stream of consciousness. It's like I'm talking to you and I'm telling you, you know, why I did this film and how difficult it was, what were the challenges of researching, my mistakes, my dilemmas, and I'm hoping that some of it will resonate with you because, you know, we are so bound by similar universal emotions that while it's very specific, it's a story about the film. And yet, if you have not seen the film, I've written that as well in the book, that if you have not seen the film, I think it'll pique your interest to want to see it. And if you've already seen the film and there are gaps that you haven't quite understood or you're fascinated by the fact that, oh, I noticed that, but I didn't know this is what went into it. Why did I choose to shoot Lahore in a small place in Gujarat? How did I even find it? You know, what was it to recreate Bombay with all the modern day clutter? Can one recreate 1940s Bombay on a shoestring budget where you are not relying on post-production and manipulations of the image? So there are lots of little stories. What is it to be a mother, a full-time mother, and do the film? You know, how you take your child in that little village in Gujarat and you live in someone's house and your son walks in and you know, 45 degrees heat, you have 250 characters to deal with. Gurdas Maan has just landed and come straight onto the set and your child is tugging at you. How do you do all of that? So it's not just the creative journey. It's also, I've shared the emotional journey, the socio-political concerns that I've had, which was the reason why I did the film. So everything has found its way into the book.
I wanted to ask, did Manto speak to you the very first time you read him? I think that was in college when you read Dastavez.
Yes. And so I saw a very bad play, actually. It was badly performed. It was Toba Tek Singh, and I saw it and I said, this story must be good. The play didn't seem to work that well. And when I came out of Shriram Center, it's a place in Delhi, and they had these 5 volumes of Dastavez in Devanagari. So I took all the 5 volumes and I started sieving through it. I must have read about maybe 20 stories. I didn't read the rest. It was with me all these years. Even when I moved from Delhi to Bombay, I brought it with me. And in 2012, which was his centenary year, centenary celebration, a lot of things were being written about him. A lot of essays were being translated as well. That's when I started reading him and getting to know him, the person. Because in essays, you are writing as first person. You know, he writes about why he drinks. He wrote about why he writes. He's written about 13 ways to bum cigarettes. He's written about how Hindi and Urdu are pretty much the same thing, and that this whole fight about the languages is so superficial. You know, he's written about graves and the politics of graves, that even that has become kitni zameen aapko dafnane ke liye chahiye hoti hai, uske bare mein bhi kuch baatein hai. So he's written about so many things that I was just fascinated. I didn't read him to make a film, but as I kept reading him, he talked about so many things that we are grappling with today, whether it's about identities, you know, how much emphasis do we give to our identities, considering we all have these multiple identities, yet sometimes some identities are thrusted upon us. You know, I'm seen as a woman director. Someone is seen as a Punjabi. Someone is seen as a Muslim. We are all of that. I mean, I'm half Gujarati, half Odia. You know, I'm a Delhiite, now I'm Bombayite, I'm an Indian. We navigate through all these identities, yet some take precedence over the other. So that's what we are dealing with today. That's what he dealt during the partition. You know, he had 6 cases on him, on his obscene, quote-unquote, writing, the ones we celebrate today. I have had my own battles with censorship, whether it was with Firaq, whether it was with Fire, whether even with Manto, and other works that we see are being censored. So freedom of speech is something I deeply care for. So I could just see so many parallels. So I felt that instead of responding to today by telling a story about today, it might be better to take refuge in Manto, in something that happened 70 years ago, and leave it to people to find those parallels. And it's really heartwarming when people do see those parallels and say, my God, nothing has changed in these years.
You know, I want to come to some of the themes in his work and that you explore in the film, but just a little bit about the process of documenting his work. And I know that the research itself took you maybe over 4 years. When I spoke earlier, the reason I mentioned it, it's an act of cultural documentation to bring all that material together in one place. Will you give us a sense of what it took to research, why it took 4 years to research a character who seems so well known?
So when you get attracted to a material or to a person or to a story, you don't really know what all it entails. You're like, oh, this would be amazing. This would be amazing to tell this story. And then I started reading, English being the language that we end up reading much of our literature in, I started reading the translations. And most of them were terrible. You know, they would use like buddy, and they would use words like Bollywood. There was no Bollywood in, you know, in the 40s. And a lot of things, every time I would see a different title. So Thanda Gosht was colder than ice sometimes. Sometimes it was cold meat. There were a whole lot of different things happening. And I was like, no, I've got to read the originals. So I pulled out my Dastavez and started reading it in Devanagari. And I realized while he writes in a very spoken language, he even uses Hindi and English words in it, but there are still some very difficult Urdu words. So I started, you know, seeing it on the net, And I realized there are very few really good dictionaries, even online. That time, Rekhta hadn't really started. Rekhta is this amazing online platform for Urdu literature. So it was really quite a battle. And then there were works that were neither in Devanagari nor in English. And Urdu is not a language that I grew up in. I mean, Dilli wali hoon, isliye zaban saaf hai. But you know, that doesn't mean that I can actually speak Urdu and definitely can't read or write. So just that process of getting to know took a long time. Then he died very young. He died at the age of 42 in 1955. So many of his contemporaries weren't there. So I went to Lahore, met his daughters. His daughters were 5, 7, and 9 when he died. So their memories were very sketchy. They were mostly memories of what their mother had said or the mother's sister had told them. And even though their memories were of the last years of Manto's life, by which time he had become an alcoholic, financially they were very badly off. So, but still their memories were, "Achha, Abba Jaan to amrood kaat ke khilate the." Or, you know, it would be about this poem he used to sing to us. And they remember it as this beautiful time. But they didn't really have things to share. It was really Safia, Manto's wife, Safia, her sister, Zakia Jalal, who's now in her late 70s, who shared stories with me. But every time I would ask her, she would break down and she would say, you know, we never really gave him his due. We never really respected him at that time. We respected him, but we kept saying, don't write, don't drink. That's all we said. And we, in fact, anyone in our family who wanted to be a writer, we would almost bar them from doing it. Because it just, every time he would write, it would be too provocative. And especially the new Islamic State of Pakistan, they would ban. So he had 6 cases, as I had mentioned. 3 were in the undivided India, and 3 were after partition in Pakistan. So they went through. So in fact, Manto's biggest dilemma in Lahore, especially in that period, was that every time he would speak about things or write things that really mattered to him, that he really cared for, and most of them were partition stories because he was deeply impacted by it, it would create problems for the family. And in many ways, he was what we call a family man. Like, he loved his wife, he loved his daughters. You know, a true feminist, not just in his work and his writings, but in the way he respected and the things he did. He would iron his wife's sari, he would cook, he would, you know, choti bana dete the apni biwi ki, and things like that. There are many such stories that not only he talks about, but the others who knew him. And that was his dilemma. So what happens to a man who wants the best for his family, but every time he writes, it jeopardizes the family? That was really his contradiction or his dilemma, which also does come out in the film. So the stories that Zakia Jalal told me were, I think, most precious. How did he sit? He would sit on his haunches, even on a chair. Even if he would go to an office, he would sit on his haunches and write. There are some scenes in the film. For instance, at one point, his wife, who's quite upset with the way he's writing, and he kind of looks at her in the film and he says, "Don't worry, you know, I'll write so much that you'll never go hungry." And she turns around and says, "That's my worry, that it's your writing that'll make us hungry." You know, so there were those kind of things. Wo Punjabi mein aur Hindi mein aur zyada khoobsurat lagta hai. But that being the thought, those kind of little anecdotes is what I got from the family. And more than Manto, what I really got from the family was the character of Safia. Because there wasn't much written about Safia. Manto, in fact, writes about the fact that he didn't want to write about the typical housewives. You know, and not that he mentioned about Safia and that, but he said, what interests me are those who are on the margins of society and not those who, what does he say, that those who get beaten up during the day and clean their husband's shoes at night, kind of metaphorically saying that those who are not rebellious, those who are taking the shit from their husbands, those women don't interest me. So he was kind of provocative to the extent of sometimes being really pushy in his ideas. So recreating Safia was something that I got from the family, because every time I would ask the family, they would say she was very gentle, she was very soft-spoken, she was such a loving person, she never raised her voice, she was very simple. And I was like, okay, that doesn't sound like a very interesting character. And that's not how I want to see the wife. You know, we are telling this story in modern times. We are also engaged on issues of women. And also beyond all of that, she must have felt agitated. It's not what she only said. What was she going through within? When you're creating characters, you're not only saying what they said and what they did, but what they felt. And for that, I think it was a real help to talk to the sister, because I had to really scratch the surface to find out that, yes, she in fact had a skin disease in the last years of her life. And after Manto died, that those rashes completely vanished. Because often emotional stress manifests itself in some kind of a physical ailment. And that gave me a cue. And what I did was I took the liberty of making Safia feistier maybe than she was. But thankfully the daughters were quite happy with the portrayal and weren't, and in fact felt that that the film in some ways represented her angst and her trauma that the mother had gone through.
You referred to something that actually leads to the question I wanted to ask right at the beginning. How much of you is in this film? It's a biographical film, so the challenge really, a work of fiction is all you. It's your prerogative. A work of biography is both him and you. What challenges does that pose?
I never even saw it as a biopic, which is kind of foolish, actually. Because after the film was made, everyone said, so, this is a biopic. I had to write everywhere, it's a biopic. And I never saw it as that. It's 4 years of Manto's life. The film really chronicles from 46 to 50. Because those were the most sort of tumultuous years in Manto's life and the life of both the countries because of the partition. So, for me, Manto was not just the man, the writer, but the idea of Manto. And when I say the idea of Manto, it's what I call the Manto yat in all of us. You know, the idea of being free-spirited, the idea of being honest to a fault, the idea of being courageous and having strong convictions that you live by. All of that for me was Manto. I think no work of art can truly be objective. You know, even journalism for that matter, because you are in some sense telling your interpretation. That's why today's journalism is, of course, shockingly subjective. That's beyond subjective. It's not even news, so we won't even go there.
It's opinion.
It's views, it's prejudice, it's biases. Let's not even start on that. But there we need objectivity, actually. So I take back my words. Let's stick to art. I think all forms of art are interpretations. They are subjective. They are a person's point of view. So this is my Manto. There could be another person and they might draw out something else. I do like being as close to the fact as possible. Also because, you know, I became so close to the family that it almost became like a personal sense of responsibility. You're depicting someone you know, someone has entrusted you with their father who was so misunderstood, who was so controversial, who was loved and admired, but also loathed and, you know, ridiculed. So therefore, I just felt an enormous sense of responsibility, and I've tried to be as true to everything that I have found out about Manto through his writing, through other people's writing. His grandniece, Aisha Jalal, a historian at Tufts, she's also written a book called The Pity of Partition. So, you know, it's taken from many writings. But there is, of course, fiction material. How would I know what Manto and Safia spoke in their bedroom? There's no way of knowing that. So, of course, I've recreated dialogues. I've imagined situations. I don't know what really Ashok Kumar did on 15th August 1947. What were people talking in the film industry? If there was a celebration, what were they talking? Were they talking about the Britishers, how they left? Or were they talking about the fact that in film studios, Muslims were being thrown out and there was a lot of pressure to sort of only keep the Hindu workers? Were they talking about that? You know, what happened the day Gandhiji died? You know, the news must have traveled. It must be on the radio. What did Manto feel when, you know, he heard that Gandhiji died? So these are real scenes. I mean, these are scenes that I have kept in the film. And They are, of course, my imagination, but the imagination is drawn from truth. Imagination has been created from facts and what I know of Manto.
You know, his relationship to, well, at that point it was all India, but his relationship to India and to Bombay in particular was almost, again, he was almost obsessed with it. And yet he did make the decision to move to Pakistan. Will you tell us a little about what triggered that very unhappy decision for him? And in your research, or did you get a sense that he regretted it, or that he thought of two terrible choices, he made the better one?
It's a spoiler. The answer is a spoiler. And I can kind of sense that not too many here have seen the film.
How many have seen the film?
Okay, better than what I'd imagined. So thank you for those who have, and too much pressure on the rest. Please watch it. why did he leave Bombay, a city that he loved so much? He used to say, ki main chalta phirta Bombay hum. When people used to ask him, when Muslims were, you know, just before partition, when Pakistan, the idea of Pakistan was formed, a lot of Muslims were being asked, are you going to Pakistan? Is that, that's going to be our land? That's the land for the Muslims. So when he was asked that, Manto sahab, aap jane wale hain Pakistan? So he had said, ki haan, agar Bombay wahan chala jaye, to ho sakta hai, uske piche piche main bhi chal padu. So that's the kind of, you know, humor that he had about Pakistan. It was not anywhere in his mind that he would ever leave Bombay. And in fact, talking of fact and fiction, your previous question, there is a little scene because Safia was pregnant when she went for a wedding to Lahore, thinking that she would come back. And Manto after that, you know, left, and then they never came back. I mean, Safia came back much later after Manto died, but now Manto never came back. And when she's pregnant, there is a small scene where they are sort of watching the Independence Day celebration from their window. And he kind of touches the baby in Safia's thing. And he says, "Tum azad Hindustan mein paida hoge." Now that line, I don't know whether he ever told Safia, but I can imagine that that's what his wish was, or that's what he thought would happen. It wasn't anywhere close to his imagination, even after partition, that he would leave. There can only be inferences as to why he left. Did he leave because there was a lot of pressure in these studios about Manto, about Muslims being thrown out of these studios, and therefore Manto was one of them who was also getting, there were anonymous letters. You know, we have trolls today, they existed then too, in forms of anonymous letters, and you know, Isma Chuktai has got anonymous letters, Manto had these threatening letters, Ashok Kumar would get these threatening letters for Bombay talkies to throw out the Muslims. He also wrote biographical sketches. The sketch about Ashok Kumar, in fact, talks of an incident where they are in a car and, you know, there's a wedding procession that's coming, which is in the film as well. And he gets so scared and paranoid for Ashok Kumar because he sees a Muslim procession coming in, and now he feels, what's going to happen to Ashok Kumar? They're going to lynch him. There was lynching then too, I guess. Partition, we're repeating the partition today. So, you know, he was really scared for him. And he writes in another essay that he got a Hindu topi and a Muslim topi. And because, you know, he said, such are the times. So, kya kare agar mazhab dilon se nikal kar sar pe chadh jaye, to topiyan pehenni padti hain. So, you know, yeah, he was great. He was full of these amazing insights, all in great humor and satire. That these are the markers today, right? How we look is going to define, our names are going to define us, not who we are. And that's why, so those could be lead-ons, but still Manto didn't leave. He never practiced his religion. He used to drink, as we know. He used to smoke. He never went to a mosque. In fact, I was very keen to shoot in a beautiful mosque in Lahore, and I got to know that from the family that he never went to a mosque, so I couldn't even set a scene in that beautiful mosque. So he was, and yet, if he is seen as a Muslim by one of his closest friends, I think that really broke him. That sense of deep betrayal, that something that I don't see myself as, I don't identify myself with my religious identity, and you are seeing me as that, somebody who's, you know, who's known me, who I have such a great bond with, even though it was for a fraction of moment, even if it was as an you know, angry impulse, but just the fact you saw me as that, I think that really broke him. So that was my interpretation, or that's what I think. And also the other reason I chose that to be sort of the camel's back that broke it was that he wrote two stories. He wrote a story on this incident, which where he fictionalized this whole incident, and he wrote an essay about that close friend called Murli Ki Dhun. So the fact he wanted to express this in more than one work, I think that in itself showed that he was so deeply impacted by that incident. And I think in that sense, and to answer your question about whether he regretted, I think he deeply regretted it. He didn't even open letters from all his close friends from Bombay. He was just so hurt. When people are hypersensitive, you know, we every day read these horrendous news in the newspapers. We know what's happening all around us. People are being killed and, you know, threatened, and children are dying of this. And there are, I mean, there's no dearth of bad news. And we say, oh my God, look where the world has, what has world come to. And yet we go on with our lives because we have thickened our skin. But Manto was deeply, deeply sensitive.
Is it an apocryphal story that he wrote a letter to Ismat Chughtai saying, or it was suggested that he said to Ismat Chughtai, if you call me, I'll come.
Mujhe wapas bula lo. He did. He actually did. And I think that was his longing. And these are the kind of informations or things that I've read in different parts. But to build it into a two-hour film and into a story was the real challenge. It's not a copy-paste that you take his essay or you take one story. I've taken lines from a story that is not even in the film. You know, so that was for me a big challenge. And I think therefore he regretted very deeply, but he was too khuddar, jisko kehte hain. He was too self-respecting almost to want to go back. You know, he wanted someone to really, I think, call him. And friends did call him, but he just didn't have the heart to open those letters. You know, it would have broken him down. And also, he wanted the best for his family. And his nephew and his extended family really took care of them. He couldn't have managed to take care of his wife and children. So I think for their well-being also, he probably stayed on.
You know, the Progressive Writers Association, and I'm speaking at that point of the Indian Progressive Writers, of which he was at once a part and yet an outsider almost. Was there a sense, did you get the sense that he was almost too progressive for the progressive writers themselves? Why was he alienated from, while being very good friends, he was often at odds with Ismat Chughtai, with Sahir, I think, with other people, Kaifi, around that time?
I wouldn't say he was at odds with it, but yes, progressives were slightly uncomfortable with it. Like, more so in Pakistan, where he was almost called a reactionary, which is crazy for a progressive to be called a reactionary. But even with the Indian progressive writers, it was a tenuous relationship. He never joined the Progressive Writers Association. You know, he used to say that if you are, agar aap insaan hai, he used to say, kya unka ek bahut achha sa quote hai, Manto ek insaan hai, aur har insaan ko tarakki pasand hona chahiye. So, you know, a human being, the mere fact that we are human beings, we ought to be progressive. That's how fiercely progressive he was. So the problem that other progressive writers of that time had, because they were talking about politics, they were talking about the society, they were talking about the British oppression, and they felt that either we should talk about hope, especially in Pakistan, that was a major issue because it was a new country. They said we should instill hope in the young people, or we should be talking about the oppression that is happening, the workers' rights. Why are you talking about sex workers? It's not even relevant right now. You know, why would you write a story about what are the, like a story like Boo? You know, why would you write about a man's sexual dilemma between this fair woman on his bed versus the ghatan, as he calls it, the you know, the working class woman and her smell? And why would you even write about these things? You are supposed to, at that time, the progressive writers were like activists, right? They had much bigger issues to deal with. And he would say everything that exists must be written about. And that was his take. He didn't compare. He wasn't trying to weigh one over the other. Jo cheez jaisi hai, use waise hi kyun na pesh kiya jaye? हकीकत से इनकार करना क्या हमें बेहतर इंसान बनाएगा? सो ही वॉज इन सर्विस ऑफ ट्रूथ, एंड ट्रूथ इज नॉट जस्ट वन. एंड बिकॉज ऑफ हिज ग्रेट एम्पथी फॉर वुमेन, दैट्स वॉट इन द नॉइज ऑफ दिस न्यू इंडिया एंड न्यू पाकिस्तान, ही डिडंट वॉन्ट टू फॉरगेट द वुमेन, द मार्जिनलाइज्ड पीपल, द टांगावालास एंड ऑल ऑफ दोज पीपल whose lives probably weren't going to change, whether there was an Angrezi sahab or whether there was going to be a brown sahab. So I think because of that, there was a certain level of discomfort. Though Ismat was a friend till the end, even though Faiz and he had a bit of a tenuous thing, which I think came out of ego, Manto's ego, because while Faiz completely supported and was a witness for Manto in the court for Thanda Gosht, when Thanda Gosht trial went on for 2 years, he did say that this story doesn't measure up to the highest standards of literature. And Manto didn't take that very kindly. And he said, "Isse acha to obscene bol dete." But you know, what does he mean by saying it doesn't? So there was a bit of that. But yet, I think they still, beyond their differences, they did support each other.
I think you've said somewhere, it's an interesting insight that comes from the story you just told, that he told the individual story. For example, he's one of the few writers writing about the partition that doesn't speak of it as an epic, who tells the very individual human story at the heart of it. Was that particular to the partition, or was that the strand in his writing that you found over and over?
Yeah, that's, I think, his writing. It's always been very intimate and very personal. He always cared about the individual human being. And through that, you extrapolate. And in some ways, that resonates with me as well. I mean, after 2002 Gujarat riots, my first film was Firaq. Again, not by design. It happened due to various reasons, mainly because it just impacted me what human beings are capable of doing to each other. And I could have done a more political film. And it wasn't about calling out who did it and blame games. I was always sort of interested in cinema being more of a mirror to show us our own prejudices, our own biases, our own fears, you know, things that we are grappling with. So in many ways, even Manto is not sort of an overarching biopic saying, "Oh, this is what happened." I could have done a cradle to grave story and told you who Manto was. But it's more intimate. It's more about, through him, we are actually talking about the times. And by talking about the times, you're talking about today and everything that we are grappling with. So in that sense, that was his style. And in fact, he's very specific. He gives the person the name, the character, who they are, a religion. But you can, in Manto's most stories, you can swap the religion and nothing would change. He was, he didn't spare anybody. Like any religion, you could, you know, there are good and bad Muslim characters, there are good and bad Hindu characters, there are good and bad Sikh characters. Because for him, at the end of the day, it was the human, the human predicament, and he believed that nothing is really all white and all black, that the best of people have their foibles, and the worst of people can be redeemed. And that's what he shows us. And I think that's so beautiful, because sometimes we tend to, especially in today's time, we are constantly being so judgmental. We are constantly labeling. In 140 characters, we are talking about things that require so much more nuance. You know, so in many ways, his stories are so nuanced and yet so sharp. That's why he's seen as one of the most amazing short story writers of all time.
I wanted to come to that, the latter part of his life where he checked himself into the Lahore mental asylum. Not because he thought
as
he was
for
insane.
Rehabilitation yeah, for of rehabilitation. His alcoholism.
And out of that experience came possibly his best known story, Toba Tek Singh. Will you tell us a little bit about why or what really led him to write Toba Tek Singh?
It was one of his last stories. We, you know, for a writer, it's very difficult to know why somebody wrote what. It's not so 2:2, as in you. It's something that probably he was struggling with and battling with from the time that partition happened. So he wrote it around 52, 53. We don't clearly know because it was published at various times. And it's really about the absurdity of partition, that this line got drawn in the middle of Punjab and, you know, partition was formed. I mean, two countries were formed and people suddenly had to choose which side of the border they belonged. And the story Toba takes in, and I'm paraphrasing it, begins with that 2-3 years after partition, the governments of both countries, India and Pakistan, decided to swap their lunatics as they had done with their prisoners. So on the basis of religion. So the Muslim lunatics had to go from India to Pakistan, and the Hindu and Sikh lunatics had to be sent from the Pakistani asylums. And the absurdity of that. And here was this Sikh lunatic who had been standing for 15 years, and he said, I'm only going to lie down when I reach my village. And that village is called Toba Tek Singh. And usually when you think of a Toba Tek Singh, you would imagine that's the name of a person. So in some subtle way, I don't know whether he was very drunk and therefore he decided, I mean, it was a slip, or whether that's where his purest idea of the person and where you belong becomes one came out. And, you know, and he writes about how this Toba Tek, this Bishan Singh, the Sikh lunatic, is just trying to find his place. He's constantly asking, bhai, bataiye mera Toba Tek Singh kahan hai? And finally, when he goes to the border where the lunatics are being transferred from the Muslim lunatics are coming to Pakistan and vice versa, and he finds out that his village is actually in Pakistan. But by the fact that he is a Sikh, he has to go to India. So where does he really go? You belong to your mitti, jisko kehte hain. You belong to your place. You don't belong to a nation only, and you don't belong only to, you know, an idea of a nation, but you belong to your own soil. And I think that's why he ended it with Toba Tek Singh lying on the no man's land and in death. That's how he sort of ends it. And in many ways, that was Manto. That was his quest as to where do I really belong? Yeah, where do I really come from? It's really fascinating. As I'm saying, I was just thinking, and I think that's what distracted me, that through the whole film, I've done now umpteen number of interviews and these kind of conversations. I've done some algebra conversations. When I was speaking about the film, and now this is my second conversation about the book, we never end up talking about the film or the book. Because the man, the writer, is so fascinating that the people interviewing me end up talking about Manto. And I'm often talking to people who are 70%, 80% don't know about Manto. And I'm still so in love with him that I'm very happy to just kind of introduce Manto, the man, the writer, the idea, that I myself forget that it's supposed to be also about the book or the film, because all those are just means to kind of share the idea of that free-spiritedness, the idea of being more truthful, more courageous. So not that I'm minding it, but it's just a thought, and I thought I'll share it with you.
I also wanted, because as you mentioned, that many of us may or may not be familiar with an extraordinary body of work that he did. Would you pick 4 or 5 stories as an introduction that you think, if we wanted to read Manto, would be a good place to start? Or would you say the 5 stories that you have kind of threaded through the film will be a good place to start?
It would definitely be a good place to start. That way they'll have to watch the film.
Why did you pick the 5 stories that you threaded
through the film? I
chose
these 5 stories because also it was part, it helped me move the narrative of the film. Right from the beginning, the first and the last story was something that, I mean, were the ones that I wanted to start with and the one that I wanted to end with. But the ones that came in the middle were the ones that would move the story ahead and were right for the time that, you know, where the story kind of meanders and sort of tells his story, because they're kind of seamlessly interspersed. And the reason they're seamlessly interspersed, because in his own writing, the line between fact and fiction is so blurred that you almost don't know whether it's a story. Did he really meet this character? Or is it figment of imagination? And so there are some other stories that I love, which are not in the film. And you know, from 300, it's difficult to really choose. But I would say watching the film and seeing glimpses of his stories that I've shown in the film would be a good starting point.
We do have 5 more minutes, and we are going to take 10 minutes for audience questions, because we knew that there might be a few. If you do, please just keep them on the ready and we'll send mics around. I have a couple more questions. One, about the relationship between art and freedom. You know, does every society should necessarily create that freedom for its artists. But one of the roles of art always seems to be to push the idea of freedom. You know, did Manto push the fundamental idea of freedoms, and in which ways do you think he did it?
Absolutely. I think you've answered your own question, actually. I think for art to flourish, you need freedom, because art is an expression, and it's a subjective expression. You know, we all can express differently, and we all don't have to agree with it, and art cannot be defined, and that's the beauty of art. And for that, you need freedom. And the societies that have grown are the ones that have been free, that have allowed their writers and poets and dancers and musicians and writers to thrive. And that's why they say art is the soul of a society. And we often think of art as something very elitist, or you have to have a full stomach to be able to indulge in art. Otherwise, you know, the cavemen and women wouldn't have painted on their caves. It's actually very primal to want to express. And also art reflects the realities of society. So it's very important that that artists are given that freedom. And to talk of pushing it, of course, that's how art also thrives. That's how freedom also defines itself. Oftentimes people ask, oh, but what about the responsibility that comes with freedom? Of course it comes. But I can't tell you to be responsible and you can't, because what is responsibility? Are you saying then censorship? That you're going to decide, five people are going to decide for a whole nation as to watch what they should be watching? Or a few people are going to tell me, or you, what we should be reading? So I don't think there is any need to really fear freedom. In fact, the more freedom you have, the more choices you have, the more slowly discerning you become. The more we should be focusing on educating us, to exposing us to different forms of art, so that we can slowly be, we are able to discriminate the good from the bad. And we know that only the good survives. The things, the songs, the poems, the work of art that we know of centuries old are the ones that survived, were the great arts. There must have been a lot of rubbish also at that time, but we don't even know of it because it didn't survive the test of time.
I think one of my questions were, and without suggesting that we seek restraint, I think my question really was, does better art come out of restraint than even freedom? Does art thrive in its resistance more even than in its liberation?
Sadly, right? I mean, we say that, you know, Iranian films are amazing because they had to find ways to express themselves because they were not allowed. You know, great poetry comes out of poverty and misery, and I think there's a bit of romanticizing of that. Why can't freedom also you know, give birth to great art? I don't know if there's any study. I'm not the person to say, because I think a lot of people with a lot of richness, from Tagore to Shaw to various people, have also thrived. Absolutely. With luxury as well. So I don't think there's one way, because it's really about the kind of people they were. How much reality impacted them? How people were they? They were people who observed life, who cared about people, who were compassionate, and who wanted to, had this great need to express. So I think those are the ones who kind of anchor towards becoming artists, because they have this, it's almost a compulsion. I mean, Manto was almost, you know, compelled to write. Otherwise, at age 42, you're writing 300 short stories and, you know, hundreds of essays and hundreds of radio plays. It's almost a compulsion. And I think, and that's why art becomes, why do we say it's the soul of society? Because it tells you things not in didactic ways. It finds a way to subliminally go into your minds. And how do we know that art really makes a difference? Is because the conservatives and the orthodox are so scared of it. Why do they want to ban a two-hour film? How many people are going to even watch it? Why do they want to ban a book? Why do they want to tear down a painting? It's because they know that it's going to impact our responses.
And a final question, since you did speak in Manto's voice in the film, what do you think he would have felt about the Citizenship Amendment Act?
Well, I'm wanting to believe that he would have felt exactly what any thinking, compassionate, sensible person, Indian, is and ought to be feeling. The difference is that many of us don't speak out, and Manto would have spoken out. He would have not feared the powers to be, and he would have said that it's the most ridiculous thing at a time, especially where this country is going through such an economic meltdown, where people are unemployed, where farmers are committing suicide, where children are dying of malnutrition, where, you know, women are suffering. There are 100,000 things. At this time, do you really want our large population, which is 40% uneducated, poor, to fill all these forms and prove that we are citizens of this country? Do you really want to divide us on the lines of religion? Isn't this the time to come closer together and define ourselves as human beings? He would have given you a bigger, harsher, ruder lecture, I can tell you that. Thank you very much.
Can we have some lights, and mics will come around if you could raise your hands. There's a question up front. We'll just get a mic to you. And may I just request, please do keep questions to questions so we can take as many as we can.
Don't be as meandering as I am. That's what she's trying to say.
That's what I was wondering, too meandering you are. Right, so... Right, so basically I read Manto's one story, I remember maybe 20, 30 years back, where I was very young. And in fact, when you said that he was very close to truth and was not afraid of saying it out, and there's a story, it was very small, where the riots were happening in Ram Manohar Lohia Road in Delhi, and that story. In fact, I felt his sketches were very short stories, some 6 lines, 7 lines.
Yeah, this is called Siya Hashye. It's a small book called Black Margins. It's really beautiful, but the one he's referring to, they were almost like haiku poetry.
Exactly.
There were 2 or 3 or 4 lines.
In fact, that reminds me, this story takes you to meditation. You know, that some kind of stillness happens to you when you read those kind of sketches. So, did you see that?
In the film as well, there's a scene where I've incorporated some of those stories.
I missed watching the film, but tonight I'm going to watch it.
It's on Netflix.
Right. Yes, it is there. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I just wanted to convey the same thing. Thank you.
Have we genuinely silenced this audience? Is there no question? I see another question. Okay. There's one at the back, then we'll come back.
Hi. I'm just curious to know, as a creative person, what is your process of creating something as original as this? And how does it... we can kind of get lost in the process of research and telling our version of the story. So how do you pull it all together? Can you give me a glimpse into your creative process?
It was a very long and arduous one. I'll try and make it short. So you do all of this research, you have so much material, and then you have to tell a 2-hour film. And the biggest challenge was that you're telling this story to 90% people who don't even know Manto, or maybe, let's say, 70% people who don't know Manto at all. Then you have 5% people who are Manto experts, who have even today read much more than I could ever read. And then you have those who are the most dangerous ones, who have half-baked knowledge of Manto. You know, like one of the reviewers said, oh, it was wonderful film, all nice thing. He says, but she's taken liberties and has used English words, you know, to contemporize it. But those were the words that Manto himself has written in his essays. But he assumed that it's an Urdu writer, he would have not used words like dry clean. I didn't even know that dry clean was even there in 1940s, but Manto writes it in his letters to Uncle Sam. He was very prophetic, by the way. He wrote letters to America, which are really quite political and very prophetic. It's about today almost. So, you know, so the act of putting it all together, the reason it took me as long as it did, because I did many drafts. Many scenes came in and went out and were thrown out, sometimes with a heavy heart, sometimes they were brought back. What to keep and what to let go was metaphorically and literally the biggest learning I've had, is this whole process of letting go. Also, whatever intention you may have, like I said in the beginning, my intention of doing the film was to respond to what's happening today. Yet, when you're making the film, you're looking at every little bit. Are the currency notes, do they look real? You know, is it, or does it look like a printed note? You know, the clock, is that fine? Is the lighting, is the color? Are the performances? Every little bit. Because what is the story you're telling and how you are telling cannot be separated either. There's this big debate in art, the form and the content. You know, what takes precedence over the other? Sometimes the big films, the more sort of glamorous films, are taken in by the form. It doesn't matter what the story is, but it's just mounted so beautifully. It's very expensive. They've used the best technology. Sometimes we are driven so much by the content that we have something really powerful to say it, but we have chosen to say it in a very boring way. And it doesn't help because it's not going to reach. So that right balance of form and content is the tough part. But again, art is not science. So you can't say, I'll put one spoon of this and one spoon of that. It just has to have its own alchemy. But because I'm not a trained filmmaker, I never assisted anybody, I don't even watch too many films. It was a disadvantage, but the advantage was that I don't know the grammar of making a film. You know, so it's also your instinct, it's your life experiences that you've had, your sense of aesthetics. Everything comes handy when you're telling this story. So it's very difficult to put the creative process in one sort of, in a short talk, but I can just say that it is the coming together of all your senses, your observations, your interests that you store subconsciously. They all come into play when you're making the choices, the artistic creative choices in doing the film.
There's two or three questions up front. If there are at the back, I'm sorry, we find it harder to see you. Do raise your hands higher if you can. Okay, so there's
hello. Mera sawal nahi hai. Main aapko mubarakbad dena chahti hoon.
Shukriya.
Kyunki mujhe lagta hai ki aapki film bahut hi behtareen hai aur film mein utni hi ruhaniyat hai jitna ki Manto ki kahaniyan mein hai. To mujhe laga ki 1947 ki लाहौर की कोई गलियों में उस मकान में एक आपने छोटी सी खिड़की खोल दी और हमको उसमें अंदर झांकने का एक जरिया दिखाई दिया जिससे कि मंटो की छोटी छोटी चीज़ें जैसे आपने बताया यू नो उनके चाय पीने की आदत है या कुर्सी पे बैठने की आदत उनकी
उकड़ू बैठते थे जिसको उर्दू हिंदी में कहते
या
कॉन्शियस
सफिया की जैसे वो हल्की सी डांट उन्हें सुनाती थी बच्चे या उनके और रिश्तेदार या जो गलियां बहुत ही उम्दा तरीके से आपने पेश किया और मेरे को लगता है बहुत अच्छा हुआ आपने फिल्म में आप बोली कि मैं ट्रेन नहीं हूं नहीं तो शायद ये कोई बंसाली की तरह बन जाती फिल्म तो बहुत अच्छा हुआ आप ट्रेन नहीं है
दैट मे बी द बेस्ट नॉन क्वेश्चन वी हैव
हर्ड वो वाली फिल्में लोग ज्यादा देखते हैं तो शायद वही कर दिया होता तो शायद ज्यादा लोग देखते हैं वो भी तो सोचिए
वी विल टेक अ कपल मोर आई नो देयर इज अ क्वेश्चन टू लेडीज इन द फ्रंट साधना एंड हियर एज वेल वी विल जस्ट गेट अ माइक टू यू
थैंक यू फॉर मेंशनिंग दैट अबाउट द ड्राई क्लीनिंग इंटरव्यू So my question is, usually a writer or an artist thinks in one language. I may not have read as much as you have on Manto, but when one reads Manto and at the time frame that he is in, it almost feels that he thinks in several languages. Would that be your experience too?
You know, he has written about Punjabi. Like when I first went to Lahore, I thought I'm going to hear this most beautiful Urdu. This was in 1996. I'd gone as part of a delegation of South Asians for Human Rights. And I crossed the border and I thought, oh, I'm going to hear this very nafiz Urdu, jisko kehte hain, bahut khoobsurat si. And they were all talking in Punjabi. And I was like, am I in India? Am I in Punjab? But it is Punjab that got divided. Just as on the other side, if you go to Dhaka, you hear, you know, Bengali with a slightly different accent. So he has somewhere said that if I could write in Punjabi and earn money, I would not write in any other language. But he wrote in Urdu because, and I think in some ways he thought in Punjabi, wrote it in Urdu. But Urdu and Hindi are actually not that different. जो अभी हिंदी यहाँ बोलते हैं, जो समझते हैं, हम लोग कहते हैं बहुत ज़्यादा. हम अधिक तो नहीं कहते. Now ज़्यादा is Urdu. हम कहते हैं हम सबका खून लाल है. हम रक्त तो नहीं कहते. हम खून कहते हैं खून तो उर्दू का लफ्ज़ है तो हिंदी एंड उर्दू वाला एक यू नो यहीं पैदा हुई है उर्दू उर्दू इंडिया की ज़बान है इट्स नॉट अ पाकिस्तानी ज़बान इट्स नॉट अ मुस्लिम ज़बान लैंग्वेज बिलोंग्स टू अ रीजन नॉट टू अ रिलीजन सो आई थिंक ही थॉट इन पंजाबी द नेक्स्ट लैंग्वेज दैट ही न्यू वॉज उर्दू शुक्रिया सो एंड देन बोलचाल की भाषा में करते थे सो इफ़ ही वॉन्टेड टू राइट अ वर्ड लाइक प्रोग्रेसिव या समाज का उन्होंने बहुत इस्तेमाल किया समाज इज अ हिंदी वर्ड बट ही हैज यूज्ड दैट वर्ड ही इज आल्सो यूज्ड वेरी डिफिकल्ट ही बाय द वे नेवर इवन कट वन वर्ड इरेजर की तो बात छोड़िए ही वुड नॉट इवन scratch out one word. Jo likh diya, so likh diya. So sometimes, and I relate to that also, because he would meander and go into something else, some other story, and then he would come back and say, I know you're thinking I got distracted, but that distraction leads me now to this. So yeah, so he, I think, thought in all these languages.
Oh, just one more question we have time for, to the side there.
Hi. So it's very clear that you are in love with Manto, and you could, like, you know,
I'm out, yes.
Yeah. But when you were making the movie, how did you get your entire team, whether it be your actors, your production set,
to fall in love with him?
To fall in love with him. Because if they wouldn't fall in love, the energy wouldn't translate. How did that happen?
You know, if you see the film, you'll know that my love, or at least I believe that if you love a person, yourself, or the country, you cannot be blinded to the extent that you do not show his weaknesses or his failings. So it's not that I have put him on a pedestal. It's not that I have not shown where his contradictions. There sometimes is more empathy for his wife than even for him. Because it mustn't have been easy for his wife to live with a man like this. It's okay for us to sit now and talk about what it, you know, about his writings and his strength and his courage and all that. But it must have been tough for her. So therefore, I think the story kind of is a very human story. It talks about a very fragile, strong, vulnerable man of many contradictions. And therefore, it's relatable. Because we all have contradictions. So I don't think it was difficult for people to fall in love with him. Some came, in fact, there are lots of actors in this film, from Rishi Kapoor to Javed Akhtar, who's never really acted. It was his debut in some ways. They've all done very small roles, you know, some for the love of Manto, some for the love of me, some for both. But I've also managed to create a lot of Manto lovers, not just in our cast and crew, but hopefully now I've just found some new Manto lovers here, I hope.
Nandita's book, and it is almost a coffee table book. What's the fact that she's a filmmaker writing is shows in that book, because it's a heavily visual book.
It's outside.
It's beautiful because there's both wonderful film stills and original pictures of Manto interspersed through that story. Please do use the opportunity. There's a few copies outside to buy and have them signed. And hopefully, Nandita...
And it's dedicated to the Mantos of the world.
Yeah.
So therefore, it's not just for Manto, it's for today's Manto.
Okay, the last word, who is a Manto?
Like I said, a Manto who has Mantoyat. And Mantoyat is, if you have the will to be more free-spirited, more truthful, more courageous, that I want to believe that all of us want to be, then Manto inspires us to be that. Thank you.